on the East Coast and hear the latest on the coronavirus pandemic. Here's the latest information, I should say. There are now more than 670,000 cases of coronavirus in the United States. More than 33,000 Americans have died from the disease. Worldwide, more than 2.1 million cases and more than 140,000 deaths. President Trump announcing new guidelines tonight for states to reopen their economies, but telling governors they will be the ones to call the shots on opening their individual states. And incredibly, saying that states which aren't being hit hard by the virus can reopen for business as early as tomorrow, as long as they meet the new guidelines. That as the CDC is reporting cases of coronavirus in all 50 states, as well as Washington, D.C. Joining me now to discuss, CNN White House correspondent John Harwood and our resident fact checker, Daniel Dale. Gentlemen, good evening. John, the president ceded to the medical experts in laying out a multi-phase approach for reopening the country. So walk us through phase one and when this could begin.
He did, Don, and it was a framework that made sense in theory without specifying how we're going to get there. First of all, a state has to pass through the gate, shall we say, to get to phase one. And through the gate, you have to have 14 days of declining COVID cases. You have to have a hospital system that can operate not in crisis mode. And you have to have enough testing and contact tracing to keep the new outbreaks under control. Not clear that any state can meet all those criteria now. But if they get to phase one, here's what it shows. Under phase one, vulnerable people will shelter in place, as they are now. Telework at workplaces is encouraged. Phased return of workers. Schools remain closed. Avoid gatherings of more than 10 people and minimize non-essential travel. That's for starters.
So, okay, John, so even when we arrive at phase two and, at phase three of these new guidelines, we won't be going back to normal, will we?
No. This is going to be a new kind of life in the United States for some time, certainly until we get the vaccine. To get to phase two and phase three, first of all, states have to pass through the same gate they passed through in phase one, declining tests, no sign of any rebound. But if you get to phase two, here's what it calls for. The vulnerable would continue to shelter in place. They would businesses encourage telework. Schools would now open. You avoid gatherings of more than 50 people, up from 10. Non-essential travel is okayed, so vacations, that sort of thing. Bars and gyms would be able to be open, although with practicing social distancing. If you get to phase three, it's much more wide open. The vulnerable populations would be out and interacting with others. Workplaces would be unrestricted. And those big sports venues, and that's one of the things that President Trump's been especially focused on, baseball stadiums, that sort of thing, could open with only limited physical distancing. That's one of the biggest questions that experts have about this framework, is whether that is a safe piece of guidance at this stage in this crisis.
So, Daniel, governors will decide when they're ready for these phases, but President Trump is claiming that coronavirus isn't an issue in some states. I want you to take a listen to this.
You have states without any problem. You have states with few cases, and those few cases have healed. You have states with very little death, relatively speaking. As I said, one is too many, but you have states with very little, and frankly, they're at a point where they have almost nothing.
What are the facts?
John, the president is a serial liar, but he's also within the category of serial lying. He's also a serial pointless exaggerator. It is accurate that some states are less hard hit than others, but the president said tonight that some states are not affected at all, and that's just not true. As of 10 p.m., the Johns Hopkins tracker had the least hit states in terms of cases as Wyoming with 296. We know that is an undercount because that's confirmed cases. We know tons of people aren't being tested. And John, the president tonight also said that some rural states won't even need to do a lot of testing and contact tracing because he said they have wide open spaces, wide open plains. We know that even the most rural states, take South Dakota, for example, we have an outbreak there because they have a pork plant where there were cases. So even those rural places have pockets of density, have factories, have places where people congregate. There is no state, even the most wide open state, that is immune from this issue.
Yeah, we're going to talk to someone from South Dakota coming up in the show to talk to them about the issues going on there. John, you know, the president still isn't being truthful about the testing problem in this country. Isn't testing an important part of the state safely assessing if they can move into these phases?
It may be the most important missing piece right now, Don, and it's a little bit strange that the president is not recognizing this. He continues to assert we have the best test, that sort of thing. Now, Deborah Birx, his task force coordinator, said tonight that she and her aides had gone lab by lab, identified some surplus testing capacity. We're now testing about a million COVID tests a week. She said they had identified unused capacity to another million a week. Experts say that's still not adequate. And the question is how the states, which are struggling to get not only testing kits, but also the swabs and reagents and other supplies necessary, as well as trained personnel to interpret the tests and administer the tests, how do they get to where they need to be so that we can safely reopen? Not clear. There are proposals on Capitol Hill for $30 billion from Democrats to beef up testing procedures and testing purchasing by states, but that has not passed the Congress yet.
All right. Thank you, gentlemen. Appreciate it. I want to bring in now Dr. Sarah Medet. She